Paul is the Anna Lauder Professor of Public Health and Dean of the Yale School of Public Health, and he is recent research includes a statewide initiative to improve cancer care in Massachusetts, which I assume involves many levels of effects, and a study of also how organizational characteristics affect the cost and quality of care with people with AIDS, and a national evaluation of continuous improvement initiatives in clinics providing care to HIV individuals. He's published over 300 articles and book chapters describing his research, and I'll let Paul take it from here to talk about methods and analytic issues.
Thanks very much, Steve. Everything I was going to say has been covered, so I'll try and be uncharacteristically concise. I think the background's pretty obvious. I think of levels of just what one is what the levels are, what the influences are, what one intervenes on. And I listed some common levels. And just to avoid the confusion, as we start talking about methodologies, when I'm working with biostatisticians or interventionists, I think it's okay for us to have different concepts of levels as long as everyone has alluded to or quite clear. I took out the slide that said the premise of multi-interventions, but I think that may be one of the most important ones to have had in here, because I will say the fact that multi-level interventions are good is a premise, and I think it's becoming increasingly clear that it's an untested premise, and for something that's really expensive and hard to do, we ought to start testing that premise. So I wasn't asked to speak about that. I was asked to speak about methodological decisions. So when you're sitting around with your multidisciplinary, multivariate team, you're going to make a variety of decisions on, first of all, what's your foci of assessment? What's the net effect on for patients? So for example, I took Jane's table one, and I said, let's say we're deciding that we want to increase colorectal or appropriate colorectal screening around patients. So that's a discussion. We have to come to that. Then we have to say, what's the effect of specific components on the level at which they are focused? So I took Jane's table. And what I mean by this is we might sit around and debate, and I'd say, okay, she says knowledge about cancer and screening options for the patient, we want to increase that. Provider team, clinician knowledge and communication about recommended screenings. We want to increase that. We want an intervention that's going to increase that. And at the local community level, we want community screening promotion efforts. So we want to increase, let's say, knowledge, behavior, and screening. But those are decisions, when we're doing research, that we have to sit down with these 200 things, you know, which are appropriate and reasonable, and make those kinds of decisions. And then, Brian covered the next point. Then we have to figure out whether we're looking at, I would have said additive or interactive, but you can use, I think Brian had a much more elaborate framework. But basically we want to know, is doing two things better than doing one thing? Is it the same as doing 1 + 1 = 2? Because 1 + 1 may not be 2. It may be, you know, 1.75 or something. Or in the synergistic or interactive, whatever nomenclature you want to use, 1 + 1 hopefully would be 3. So it may be that if we just go out and educate individual patients, we increase the screening rate by 1%. If we educate physicians, we increase the screening rate by 3%. But maybe when they start talking and they all agree and there's all this complex processes that we go on, gee, maybe we get 15%. But those are testable questions that I think we want to get to. And of course, mechanisms, complexity, non-recursive, et cetera, et cetera. Anyone who's done evaluation research knows we want to try and understand the mechanisms, the processes, the feedback loops, and so on. And then there are a whole host of methodological decisions that follow from those, and I've listed some here. And the only reason I list them is I was struck, and I felt validated by Kurt's meta-analysis, that a lot of these things are just not done. So we don't think about whether, when we're looking at, let's say, local community and community screening rates, are we interested in what it is about the community that promotes those things? Are we interested, what's the process, the outcomes? And we have to come up with measurements of those things. Methodologists, like me and my colleagues who sit around, we have to think about aggregations of data. Are we operating, what do we mean by a community? What are the units? What do we aggregate? Not just for the intervention, but for the analysis. And there's a whole host of statistical issues that drive from that. And then This is the big one. I think the reason we haven't done more of this, because it's really hard to do. And I'm going to make an assertion. I'm an avowed logical positive, and I agree with the comment that we have to look at all this complex stuff, but I would say we often neglect to have really good, rigorous comparisons to know whether this community intervention resulted in more community awareness than if we had not done that community intervention. Now, if I'm talking about communities, it's really hard to randomize 3,000 communities or even 10 communities, so it's really, really hard, but often we don't know that, and often we have no idea what the impact of that community intervention was, what the cost of it was, or what the relative cost of different approaches would be. So the challenges, I think, are self-evident. I was asked to write about analytic methods. I don't think that's an issue. I think we have very, very good analytic models for hierarchical, nested, non-nested, I think we have really, really good statistics. I also think we have really, really good research design. So I don't think finding a really smart statistician or methodologist is the rate limiting step here. I think thinking about what the foci are and how to get the control groups to evaluate even the level specific effects, much less the mediating, moderating, synergistic effects, is really, really hard. Think about Steve, when we were talking about doing things in Massachusetts, we're doing HIV interventions now in Connecticut. So if I intervene in the entire New Haven community, what's my comparison group? How do we find it? How do we get them to submit to measurement and so on? So it's really tough, and it's expensive and hard. This is really inspirational, right? This is the point I made before. That there is, I said surprisingly, I would say shockingly little information, both about the effects of the components. So a lot of the ones I read said, well, we did 14 things and the net result was a 5% increase in people quitting smoking, but we don't know what the components are, either at their level, in other words, what happened at the doctor's offices, did the doctor's attitudes change, or what the impact of those changes were on that smoking rate or that prevention screening rate or whatever. A final point, Joe's going to be talking about modeling, and I'm really enthusiastic about that. It struck me how little we know about the relative costs of doing these things. As I said, I'm trying to plan a community-wide strategy for promoting HIV screening and linkage to care, and you come up, when you talk to the people at the state, we say, well, if we have X dollars, what's the best way to spend our money? You've given me the 43 studies about how to increase screening rates, but if you want me to do something at the community level, what's the impact of those 14 evidence-based interventions? What's the cost of them? How do I model that, taking into account context? Because I want to work in different communities and so on. So that's a really tough one. I have an answer for all of these, but I'll pretend like I'm open to inquiry. must we sacrifice resolution and evaluation designs to achieve impact? In other words, you know, do we do the whole enchilada saying, okay, we're going to do the community, blah, blah, we're going to do the 14 things because we really want to have the impact, which is what I'm hearing in HIV, or do we really want to understand more about the components, the interactions? I lean towards the latter, and I can argue that at our table. I'm kind of simple-minded. A lot of times when I sit down with people designing interventions, do you do the whole enchilada, see if it works, and then tease out the components, or do you start with the components and build up? So if I'm doing a clinic intervention, do I educate the physicians, change the systems, educate, do I do the 14 things, see if I can get an impact, because it's so hard to get an impact doing anything, or do I do the little components? Now you might say, we have the components, we have the evidence that they work, but I would challenge all of us, I don't think we've done the comparison. So if I go back to Jane and say, Jane, gee, I just found 43 papers about increasing knowledge about cancer and screening options. What do I do in Connecticut? I don't think we've done the comparisons or the costs or the modeling or the impact in different contexts. And I'll just mention, we've been complaining there's not enough money to do it. There's $1 billion on the table to do comparative effectiveness research. And comparative effectiveness research applies to systems and systems approaches. So I challenge us to do that. So my questions, and I'm trying not to delay lunch here, Is there, again, I know the answers, is there additive data about adequate data? No, we don't have adequate data. Should there be more emphasis on understanding? Yes, there should be more emphasis. And should we focus more on the cost effectiveness? Your tables actually have a simple, yes, we should focus more on those things. So that's my talk. Thank you very much. And I tried not to delay lunch.
Thank you very much, Paul.